claiming of the nations. He knows. I know he knows. Just the way, same way he knew history. He knew the beginning of time. He knew where he was going. That's why he could sing the song. That's why he encourages Israel. He says, you are God's people. You are chosen for greatness. He says, yes, you will go into exile. But like in the back, he wants to tell them, but there's great purpose for that exile. And not until Acts chapter 2 do you see the whole plan coming together. Look at Acts chapter 2 with me, everybody. Let's read something we've read 1,000 times before. And when the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven. Suddenly there came from heaven. God's going to reclaim the nations in Genesis 10. And a noise like a violent rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues. This divided tongues does line up with the divided tongues in Genesis 10. That same word, divided, is the same word God used when he said, I divided them. I divided their languages. It's the same language. Same language. The divided tongues of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were Jews living in Jerusalem, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the crowd came together and they were bewildered or confused. That is the same word that is used when God confused the language of the people in Genesis. It says they were confused because each of them was hearing them speak. Each one of them was hearing them speak in his own language. Now God, look at this, guys. God confused their language in Genesis. Here, with the power of the Holy Ghost, God now causes his chosen people, the Israelites, to speak into the language of all 70 nations. All 70 nations were coming out of the Jews because all 70 nations were in Jerusalem for the time of Pentecost. It says, and they heard them speaking in their own tongue. I don't know if it exactly said. And they were preaching the gospel. What they heard them preaching the gospel. They were amazed, saying, Why are not all these who are speaking Galileans? Why? I said that wrong. Why? Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we each hear them in our own language to which we were born? And then look at the names. God specifically writes the names of the nations. Does anybody want to read those names? No. No, okay. The Parthians, the Medes, the Elamites, the residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, And these, you can go back to Genesis, these are the table of nations right here. These are the table of nations. So what God has done in Acts is now he has used his chosen people, which he had planted in every nation of the globe, to reclaim the nations for him. And you know what happens all through the book of Acts? All through the book of Acts, God reclaims the nations. What happens after Judea? Next is Samaria. Next is Ethiopia. You remember Philip with the Ethiopian eunuch? Next Paul is converted, and he is the apostle to the Gentiles. And then what did he do on his missionary journeys? He circled all 70 nations. Next was Cornelius. And then, you know, Scripture also says that he also went to Rome and he went to Spain. And he reclaimed the nations for God. Now, I see that in the physical sense, how God dispersed the nations. He called his people. He dispersed his people. He reclaimed the nations. And it's the ultimate plan of God. I pray that is enough just for us to see that God operates in ways far beyond our understanding. And what we see is failure and broken down and things that we can't understand. God is in the midst of it all, doing amazing things. But this is really, and that's very powerful. It's very God. But I always want to bring it home to us. And I don't know if I can fully bring it home to you, because only the Holy Spirit can, and he'll speak to you and give you as much as he wants you to have. But the truth is, I'd say, man, the truth is this. Do you know how Paul got to Rome? You know how he got there? He had to be arrested. Now, when God called Paul, man of God, I'm sure he didn't plan on being beaten and being arrested. But that's how God chose for him to go to Rome. Same way he chose for the Israelites. How did the Israelites, how were they dispersed? Through treachery, through hard times. It seems as if that Paul could have been named among the transgressors. Do you know it says that Jesus was named among the transgressors? Didn't he hang upon the cross with two malefactors on the side of him? He was named among the transgressors. Do you know how God is going to save the transgressors of the world? Okay, I'll tell you. He's going to cause you or something in your life, but he will name you among the transgressors. He might have you nailed to a cross. He might have you sent to jail. He might have you beaten. He's going to have you involved with every other sin and transgression that the world has been involved with so you can somehow infiltrate where they are. He's going to have every one of you be involved in every kind of thing in this world so you can infiltrate them. And I don't want to go down a list. I really don't. I want God to speak to you. But some of you will experience some things so you can walk through doors that no one else could walk through. Some of you have to be arrested and have to be a prisoner to really minister to the prisoners. Some of you have to be sick in order for you to minister. God does work that way. Some of you have to experience certain things. You have to be named among the transgressors, and that's his way of dispersing you so that you can reclaim the nations. So when you go back in there, it's like, hey, you're one of us. Well, I'm one of you, but I'm really here to save you. And you know, the truth is, you might not even know it. You might just consider yourself to be a transgressor. You might consider yourself to be a failure. I fail God. I got this in my life. I can't get that out of my life. I constantly struggle with this. But I want us to understand the plan of God in it all. We're not failures. God is so sovereign. He's so big. He doesn't see and judge as we see and judge. And he allows you to experience certain things. He causes light and darkness. He causes evil and good. He causes all things in your life because he's going to get you where he needs to get you because he's going to spread you abroad. He's going to disperse you around. And everyone in this room has a different situation in life. Everyone has a different situation in life. Whatever your horror or your failure is, God said, I'm using you. He sent you there so that you can get everybody in that same category. And I'm talking about everything. I really am. I'm talking about different lifestyles. I'm talking about addictions. I'm talking about whatever you think is so evil. God will cause it to be named, if not among you, he'll cause it to be named in your family. You ever think, like, I never thought this would happen in my family? Well, there's a reason for it. Now this is in your family, your heart has just changed towards that disposition. You might have thought that this thing, whoever had this thing in their life, was the devil and they were going to hell. But then somebody in your family came and sat at your table, someone who you loved and cried with, and said, this is who I am, this is what I'm experiencing. It will change your world. You won't be so quick to send the whole world to hell when one of them is your sons or your daughters. You will not send them to hell. You will save them. You'll say, hey, wait a second. You're not going to go to hell because I'm going to do everything in my power to save you. I'm going to preach the good news. Listen, I'm going to reclaim you. And we thought it was for evil. We had no idea it was for good. God sent Joseph as a prisoner. Joseph was in prison 13 years of his life. He was in the dungeons. Imagine what that might have done to him. He was like every other criminal. Worse. Nobody knew who he was. But God said, I sent you there to save the world. You're not going to save him from an ivory tower. He's going to put you in the pig pen with them. Oink, 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 oink. And you're going to speak their language. Oink, 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 oink. I wonder how that works on tape there. You're going to know their language. You understand that? He's going to divide your tongue. You're going to know their language. You're going to smell like them. You're going to be one of them. God got Paul to Rome, all right. He did it as a prisoner. And at the end of it all, he was convicted as an enemy of the state and executed. But he did reclaim the nations. I know this Bible is not full of failure. I know my life and your life is not filled with failure. I know there's not failure in your family. I know there isn't. There's God. We just don't see it and understand it, but God wants us to. The day and age we're living, he wants you to see it. He wants you to understand it. He wants you to be effective. He wants you to reclaim the nations. Revelation is all filled with it. It says those those who overcome, he says, I will cause them to have the iron scepter and they will rule the nations. In essence, they will reclaim the nations. They will have my rod and they will have the morning star. Who will? Those who overcome, those who reclaim the nations. Reclaim the nations. Now, you can call them Greece, Rome, Germany, or you can call them alcoholism. You can call them theft. You understand what I'm saying? But you're going to reclaim everyone that's behind those bars. Everyone. And we're going to stop throwing the people away. We're going to go through those prison doors. Some of you are going to go through as prisoners yourself of whatever the bondage is. You will be prisoners yourself of the same bondage, but the reason why you are a prisoner in that bondage is to set the prisoners free. So when God breaks those shackles and opens up those doors, not only do you walk out, but everybody in that prison walks out. Yeah. That's the gospel, everybody. That's the song of Moses. Now, I don't know if I can sing that just yet. But there is one who does sing over us. Amen? Okay, that is the word of the Lord. I'm going to ask you all to stand and let God do his work and speak to us and change our lives. Amen? I'm going to say a prayer. I'm going to pray for our pastor, Dad, tonight as we all stand, if that's all right. Okay, thank you, Jesus. Lord Jesus, my Lord God, you are beyond our understanding. But you are giving us eyes to see and ears to hear, and you are causing us to have hearts to understand. You're changing the way we see and the way we live, the way we judge. Yes, my God, you are changing us entirely. And I pray that we would see you, my Lord God, in all of your glory, and that the earth would be filled with the knowledge of your glory, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the great things that you're doing in this house. We thank you for this family, for everyone who you brought through the doors this day. I pray, my God, that you would speak to them through the night and the days. I pray that you would just tell them, my Lord God, your purpose and your plan. You would fill them with hope and direction. I pray, my God. I pray that you continue to use this house for your glory and may next week be a powerful week. I pray, my God, that you would open us up again to who you are. But even as we close this night, my God, we do pray for our founding father. We thank you for the man that you have called, and you said that you would make yourself a nation right here. And we thank you for the one that you chose, and we pray, my God, that you give him life and breath and strength, that you give him new life. We pray, my God. And we thank you for the man that you chose, my God, to found this great work. And with that foundation that's been laid, I thank you, my Lord God, for the house that is here. I thank you for each stone that you put together, one stone upon another stone. I thank you for the house, my God, and we thank you that you called us together and you called us by name. I pray the Spirit of God rise up inside each and every one of us, my God, and that there be a mighty house built here right in Lehigh Acres. My God, we claim Lehigh Acres. We reclaim Lehigh Acres, my Lord God. We say let our town, let our families, let our neighbors know, my God, how great you are. And that they would know it because of the extreme love and mercy and forgiveness. Lord, be with us, guide us, fill us, renew us, restore us. It's in the precious name of Jesus we pray. Everybody says, amen. Amen. God bless you.